सुनाई दे रहा है ना?
Lots of good mornings have come. So, good morning to all of you. Navid Kumar Saraf Saab has also joined us. Namaste. Yes, it is 11 o'clock and let us start on time and end on time. Today, I'm going to talk about this very interesting thing sitting right up here, which is called the brain. Not all of us have it, of course. Sometimes I myself doubt whether I've got one or not. But then generally people are supposed to be having a brain, right? Now, what is this thing called the brain? Let me first start with the body before we talk about the brain. The human body, as you know, even if you have done a very cursory research or thought about the body, you will know that it is a phenomenon. The way the body functions, not even the most complicated computers can function according to that. The way the body starts, from the time there is a fetus inside the womb of the mother and it starts forming an independent identity till the umbilical cord is cut and the baby becomes an independent entity, going on to 80 years, 100 years, whatever the age of that living being is, every minutest part of the body functions so beautifully. You don't need annual maintenance contracts, you don't need replacements, you don't need upgradation to body 2.0 or heart 3.0 or something of that sort. The same heart which you had as a small baby or even as a fetus, that heart continues for 100 years to serve you and things like that. Now, among all these organs in the body, there is one organ which is an enigma, and that is the brain. Sitting happily over here, well protected by that thick skull, so that even if somebody hits me on the head, the brain doesn't get damaged so easily. We have this thing sitting there called the brain. You must have heard people saying that the brain is the last frontier of medical science. In all other areas, we have made such tremendous progress. Take a vital organ like the heart. Since 1968, I think, when Dr. Christian Bernard did the first heart transplant operation, it has been 50 years now. heart transplants are done all over the world, including in India, including in our hometowns, everywhere, you know, heart can be replaced. We are also coming very close to getting artificial heart. So you won't even have to wait for a donor. We will very soon be probably having, you know, artificial hearts, which a person can just maybe order through Amazon or something of that sort. Or you don't even have to go to the mall, and then the heart comes and then you give it to your cardiac surgeon and he fits it into you. And he checks out your parameters and says, okay, go back home and enjoy life. That is the extent to which the medical science is advancing. And that is the extent to which every complicated organ in our body can be taken care of. But when it comes to the brain, things become a little different. Firstly, let me also tell you something that there is a difference between the brain and the mind. Okay. Very controversial and a very deep issue. What is the brain and what is the mind? Now, today, I am not going to discuss the mind because it's a fascinating and an intriguing subject, which I can speak on for hours and hours. And in the end, I'll be more confused than how much I will be confusing you. So I'm not going to talk about the mind today. We are going to talk primarily about the brain. At least, if nothing else, the brain is a tangible organ. You can actually see the brain. It doesn't look so all that great to see. It's quite a ugly looking thing. Doesn't matter. But it plays a very important role, right? To the extent what we don't even realize, for example, people say things like, you know, I love you with all my heart. I love you from the bottom of my heart. There is nothing in your heart which creates love. The heart is nothing but an ordinary pump. Its job, one and only job for 100 years that you live, is to keep on pumping blood. That's it. And yet we have these misconceptions. We think that we love with our heart. We don't. We love with our brain. So see the type of roles that the brain plays, right from cognition to making the body functional, to so many things, right down to falling in love also is a brain activity, not a heart activity. We must understand all these things. The other thing is that neither are we able to have a brain transplant, nor does it look likely that at least in the foreseeable future, we will be able to have a brain transplant or an artificial brain or anything of that sort. So it's a very, very valuable organ, which we have to preserve at all times. You may be also be aware that, you know, medical personnel, when do they declare a person to be dead? It is when his brain stops functioning, not when his heart stops functioning. There are innumerable cases where a person's heart stops functioning and they revive the heart and there it is. The person is back to normal life. But there again, you know what they say? If you do not revive the person fast enough, if the heart is not pumping blood for those crucial few minutes, then the blood does not reach the brain and the brain can get damaged. And once the brain is damaged, then lifelong you're a cripple or whatever it is. So finally, everything boils down back to only the brain. That is what I want us to understand its significance. Take a case of somebody's body becoming malfunctional. Let's say a hand or leg of mine is amputated. Or even worse, I have a spinal cord injury and my body becomes dysfunctional. I become a paraplegic or a quadriplegic, where I lose control over the lower part or the middle part of my body. My brain is still functional. Even a person, you will recall, Stephen Hawking. His body was paralyzed so badly, he could not lift up a little finger. He couldn't lift up either his hands or legs. He had no bodily function left. He couldn't even talk. It was that bad. But his brain, you know how much his brain functioned. He was called the modern day Einstein. So even with a completely paralyzed body, there can still be a wonderful quality of life. But visualize the other way around. Your body is fit and fine. Your brain stops functioning or, you know, starts deteriorating. Then what happens? Life can be absolutely miserable. In the extreme case, let's say a person goes into a coma. The entire body is functional, but the person is flat on bed. He cannot talk, he cannot hear anyone else. He can hear, but the brain doesn't process that hearing for anything functional. He can do absolutely nothing. He's a vegetable. Even though, if you examine every individual part of his body, starting with the important organs like heart, liver, kidneys, all these things, going on to hands, legs, eyes, nose, mouth, ears, every one of them is functional. But the person is as good as dead. Why? Because he went off into a coma and his brain stopped functioning. Once you understand this concept and understand the significance of the brain, let me come to the topic of today, that we tend to take our brain for granted. We do not give it sufficient significance the way we give to our body, because the brain is not visible. See, I use my legs for walking. If I realize that I'm having difficulty in walking, I've started limping, or at the end of the day, my legs start paining or they get swollen or something, I immediately take cognizance of it and say, no, I better do something about it, because otherwise, I won't be able to walk if this continues. So I have to go for some treatment, some physiotherapy, some nutrition, some exercises. Whatever I have to do, I will do, so that I will make sure that my legs continue to remain functional. Like that, any part of the body, if my eyesight starts failing, I'm immediately aware of it. So I go, I get specs. If I have a cataract, I get a surgery done. So since all the other organs are so visible, it becomes easy for us to take cognizance of it and do things. So much so that even when all our organs are fully functional, we still do something or the other to keep them functional. You may be a young person, perfectly fit and fine, with all your organs working fantastically, but you still do exercise. You may join a gym. You may get up early in the morning and go for a walk or a jog. You may decide that I will eat only wholesome, nutritious food. You will decide on the right type of clothing so that it suits your body to the best possible ability. You decide the place where you sleep so that everything is taken care of. In the winter, you ensure that you have a blanket or a sweater or whatever. It is so much care we take for our body for the rest of it, except the brain. Because you never come to know when the brain is malfunctioning. Sometimes till it is too late. So, I want you to understand that the brain works on the same principle as the rest of the body. There is this proverb which says, use it or lose it. If you do not use a particular organ, you are, possibly going to lose it. Do you want to take that risk? We don't take that risk, as I told, with any other organ. The moment my eyesight starts failing, I immediately go running to the doctor, get my specs, get this, do that. When I find my hand or leg is shaking or is becoming a little weak, I immediately get everything done. I don't do the same for my brain. Probably because we don't even understand what this brain is all about. So let me tell you a few very, very simple facts. I'm not a neurologist. I don't pretend to be one. And I don't talk the language of neurology. But as a layperson, what do we understand about the brain? What do we need to understand about the brain? And therefore, how do you need to take care of the brain? It is said that the brain has what they call as the left hemisphere and the right hemisphere. Okay. The right hemisphere generally controls the left side of our body, and the left hemisphere controls the right part of our body. So if I have a brain damage on the left side of my brain, you will see that I become a hemiplegic. That means my right hand and my right leg are not functioning anymore. And vice versa. That is the physical part of the thing. The more important part of it is that the left brain is the brain that controls mathematical thinking, logical thinking, analytical thinking, sequential thinking, experiential thinking, intrapersonal decision-making thinking. These are all the factors which are controlled by the left brain or the left hemisphere. The right brain controls the emotions part of it, interpersonal relationships, creativity, intuitive, and you know, that sixth sense and instinct and all that, kinesthetic ability, literary ability. These are all things which are controlled by the right brain. So let me start off with one very, very important thing. See, the best people, since I keep doing this aptitude testing for a lot of students and also for adults who want to change career, one of the things that I assess is this individual left brain or right brain, right? Depending on that, we can tell where he is going to shine. A left brain person obviously will do well in mathematical, logical, analytical thinking and careers which are connected to that. Same way a right brain person will do very well if it's something to do with literary or human relationships or emotional aspects and things like that. So that's why we do this assessment in depth to find out. Once in a while, I come across a person who has got a balanced left and right brain. Both of them are equally developed. Those are the very lucky ones. They are unlucky in the beginning because they are more confused than the others. They have a pull in two different directions. But as they go along in life, they start getting more and more focused. And more so, if they select the right thing to do, they will find that they are on a path where they cannot have any failure or any setbacks in life. So we encourage people to find out, you know, which hemisphere of the brain is stronger. But once you get into a career which is related to whichever part of your brain is strong, what do? You inevitably start neglecting the other part of your brain. Supposing you are a very highly qualified and a very competent chartered accountant. You're so passionate about your work, you're so involved in your work, probably not just 8 hours, but 10 hours, 12 hours, 14 hours. You are with numbers, purely left brain activity. So over a period of time, while you're doing exceedingly well in your profession and people are looking up at you, you're making money, you got respect and honor and credibility and all that, at the same time, your right brain starts atrophying, deteriorating. You're not using it. So that is the basic theme of today's talk to you. Please ensure that you use all parts of the brain. Please make sure that you do not neglect. It's like, you know, I want to keep my body fit. So I am exercising my right hand all the time, but I neglect my left hand. What will happen? I need both hands, isn't it? There are a lot of activities which I can't do with just one hand. So when I say exercising my hands, I have to exercise both hands. I have to exercise both legs. That is what is important. The same way, you need to exercise both sides of your brain. What you are normally doing takes care of one side of the brain. Supposing you are a designer, an artist, a creative person, your right brain is very, very functional, very sharply developed, and you do exceedingly well. You enjoy what you are doing and things of that sort. But what happens? Your left brain starts atrophying. Now, when that happens, initially, you may not realize. You may be so caught up with whatever work you're doing and the type of lifestyle that you're leading. And more so, if you're successful in whatever you're doing, you don't even have any doubt. You don't even have the need to look into the other angles of your life which you are neglecting. Till you start somehow feeling that something is not going okay. I know so many left-brain people who inevitably land up with relationship issues. Somewhere or the other, they start having issues with regard to relationships, because relationship is a right brain activity. You are sharpening and continuously sharpening your left brain, and people sometimes wonder, this man has gone up the ladder, he is doing so well, he is holding such a high position, he can solve problems in minutes which people can't do in days. But why is it that he has a short temper? Why is it that he cannot understand other people? Why is it that he gets into these unpleasant relationship issues? Because he has neglected that part of the brain. And from there, life can be a continuous downhill, right up to the point where in your old age, you may land up with dementia or Alzheimer's disease. Sudha has asked how to ensure that I use both sides of the brain. That's what I'm exactly coming to, that step by step, Sudha. So what we need to do is to prevent anything of this sort happening. The same way as I say that, okay, my heart is fully functional, my body is fully functional, but when I grow old, my heart will be weak, my body will be weak. So the more I do exercises, the more I keep myself fit, the better I will be when I'm 80, 90, 100 years also, my body will be functional. The same thing we need to do over here with the brain. You're all aware of this thing called Alzheimer's disease or dementia and all those things, right? Many of us have not given it enough attention because it is a disorder that happens only to very old people generally. After 60, 65, they say about 5% of the people may get Alzheimer's disease. But after 80, 85, that 5% goes up to 20, 25%. And knowing the longevity, the way longevity is increasing, chances are very bright that you are going to live far beyond 80 years of age. So you have almost a 25% chance of acquiring Alzheimer's or dementia. And you know how horrifying it is. I told you, when your mind stops functioning, what's the advantage of having a fully functional body? You're like a vegetable. You're sitting in one place. Your body is fully functional, but you don't know what to do with your body. You don't know how to talk. You don't know how to interact. You can't do your normal routine work or anything of that sort. So taking that into account, whatever your age is, whether you are 20 or 60, doesn't matter. You have to start using all parts of your brain. And to do that, you have to look for activities which are diagonally opposite to the activities which you do on a regular basis. So like I gave the example, supposing you are a technology person and IT person. Now you are spending all your working life only doing things which are directly connected to binary, that is one and zero type of thing. So what you need to do now is to move on to doing things which are the opposite of what you are doing. So maybe sit down and start writing poetry. Maybe take a pen and paper and start drawing sketches and something of that sort. Exactly, Mr. Navneet, what are the preventive measures? I'm talking exactly about that while Alzheimer's does not have a cure, there are proven methods of minimizing, I won't even say preventing, minimizing the chances of your getting dementia or even that senility, as they call it. Hindi mein bolte hain satya gaya hai, that sort of thing, where a person seems to be losing his balance and losing his memory and those sort of things. So when you start using all parts of your brain, you are minimizing the chances that any such thing will happen to you in old age. So start looking for all such possible different types of activities. There are so many of them. But what I will do is I will demonstrate to you 2, 3, 4 of them so that you get a illustrative idea. Beyond that, I want you to look into this if you're seriously interested, explore. If you want individually, you can get back to me. We can discuss it on a one-to-one basis, depending on your needs. And as I told you, depending on what you are doing and where you are lacking in what you are doing. So it has to be individual based. But just to start you off in something very, very simple, to check out and also to see whether both sides of your brain are working, and starting with this left hemisphere and right hemisphere, as we say, check out a very, very simple exercise. Hold your hands, like this. Raise up this thumb and open this finger. Raise up this thumb, open this finger. Then open this finger, raise up this thumb, reverse the thing. Then reverse the hands, this thumb, this finger, this thumb, this finger. Then this finger, this thumb. start doing this on a continuous basis as fast as possible. Very simple. How much time does it take? 1 minute, 2 minutes. But you are starting at the first level, that is the left part of the brain which controls your right and the right part of the brain which controls the left. You are practicing. And when you go very fast at it, you will see whether you're making mistakes, whether you're getting confused, or whether you're being able to do. So you yourself will get an answer. How much is the need and how much you need to do. Starting from there, we also can do simple exercises to check out and to improve whether both sides of your brain, when they are required to be going, whether they are working at the same level or not. I'll just, before that, digress for a minute to tell you how even, you know, the brain gets fooled by certain activities, and you can literally program the brain. There was a very interesting experiment done, and I must say, hats off to it. The doctor who did it, who's a very eminent neurologist, I'm forgetting his name, is a man of Indian origin, and then he has settled down in USA, and he, you know, did this from where the thinking about the brain has completely changed. You are aware of the fact that if a person gets a leg amputated, supposing I have a very bad accident and one of my legs has to be cut off and amputated. Now, I don't have that leg. Let's say I don't have a right leg. Okay. Can I get pain in my right leg? You will say, obviously, no. But the fact is, I do. You will get a patient, doctors will tell you that they get patients who come to them and say, doctor, I'm getting shooting pain in my right leg. And the doctor looks and says, you don't have a right leg. How can you get? So that is what is referred to as phantom pain. The brain does not recognize that my leg is gone. And when he sees that the nerves and this and that are not connecting something, I'm not getting the proper signals, the pain starts in the brain. Now, what this doctor did was a wonderful thing. He just made a plywood box with holes in it. So you push both your legs into it. One non-existent leg because it's been amputated, and the other full-fledged leg. Yes, so I think it was Emerging Minds. I'm also not very sure. We can check it out and see the thing. Anyway, there was a mirror there. That mirror gives you the illusion that your left leg is actually your right leg, because you know the in a mirror the left becomes right and right becomes left. Now you look at what you think is the right leg. And you massage it, or you put some oil on it, or you do something, and that pain goes away. The pain that you are getting in your non-existent right leg has gone off. Because you fooled the brain by treating the left leg, which in the mirror looks like the right leg. I'm oversimplifying and telling you. You can read it up in detail if you're interested. The point being that the brain can be programmed. That's what I want you to understand. Also remember, don't even, let's not even talk about old age and this and that. Many young people say, we'll see what that happens. We can't connect really to old age so easily. Even today, to have a sharper memory, to be able to connect, to be able to take the right decisions. If you're a person who uses both sides of your brain, you know, gives exercise to both sides of your brain. I'll give you a simple, Dr. Ramchandra, is it? Yes, Satyan, I think that's the right name, if I also remember right. Now, using, yes, phantoms in the brain, that's right, Kana. Phantoms in the brain is the name of the book I recollect now by Dr. Ramchandra. And there he has explained this in minute detail. So don't go by what I'm telling you. I'm just giving you a quick gist of it as a layman. But if you really want to understand this concept, it will help you to focus on it and to realize the significance of the thing. That is most important. So what we do is start, you know, using both sides of your brain to ensure that you will not have short-term memory lapses. You will not have difficulty in taking decisions or something. You will not have difficulty in doing what we normally call as non-programmed decisions, something which you are not used to be doing. You'll be amazed if you read in history, a lot of, you know, expert mathematicians were also musicians. Now, music is a right brain activity. mathematics is a left brain activity. How comes the topmost mathematicians were also musicians? Whether they did it publicly or not, but they could play music beautifully. I was very intrigued when I heard about that, and I went deeper into it. You see, playing music is actually a mathematical activity. That after this button, you press this key. After this key, you press that key. It is sequential thinking. This leads to that. This tone goes into this. So that sa, re, ga, ma, pa goes in a sequence. So then I found that these great mathematicians were good at playing music. But you ask them to create music, they were zilch. Because that is the true right brain activity. I'm just giving it to you as a quick example to show you that we need to be understanding, we need to go in depth and work on these things. You're a right brain creative person, look for logical left brain things. Start doing Sudoku or crossword puzzles and this and that, where purely the logical and sequential mind is required. If you are a person who's all the time indulging in left brain activity, as I mentioned, take up doing something like creating music or writing some articles and blogs or doing some sketching or painting or anything of that sort, even gardening for that matter, purely a right brain activity. Where do I put this? How do I shovel this? How do I remove these? Those sort of things. All these things can be done. I made a couple of my friends do another exercise, which involves a leg and a hand. You yourself will get an idea. Have a look at these two people. I asked them to lift up their right leg and start rotating it in a clockwise manner. So here you see Sunita. She is lifting up her right leg and she is rotating it in a clockwise manner. Then she is rotating her right hand in an anti-clockwise manner. When you do it for some amount of time, some of us will realize that our leg refuses to do clockwise movement. It starts either floundering or it starts going in the anti-clockwise direction. Here is another example. Sonal. Yeah. Comparatively, Sonal seems to have done much better. Sonal could very systematically rotate her leg in the clockwise direction and lift up the hand and rotate in it. Initially, if you saw, she had a little bit of difficulty, but then she got into it and then she's doing it very smoothly. I want you to do the same exercise for yourself. Firstly, if you're having difficulty doing it, that means you're not using both parts of your brain. And if you do this as an exercise, as I told you, it's a very simple exercise which will help you to understand how to use both sides of your brain. I'm starting with very basic things. I will just run you through a few more of these and give you some very, very basic tips on how to use both sides of your brain. And then, of course, as we always do, we will have the open house and your chat box and all these type of thing. What if you're reasonably good at both activities and yet you have problems with remembering and this and that? No, that is an oxymoron. You are not good at both. These are only simple examples that I've given, Neelam. It could be so many different ways in which you have to keep testing yourself. You will find if you are having problems with remembering names and this and that, you have, neglected. No, not right now, Sunita. I don't want that right now. Okay. Yeah. So I'm going to be giving you some activities. Let's take a quick 2-minute break as we always do. And then I'll continue with a few more tips and techniques. And of course, responding to the type of doubts and questions that you have.
Hi, so the best way I feel to use all parts of your brain and to keep yourself agile, active all the time is to also upskilling yourself from time to time. Here in Banjara, we do a lot of activities, workshops, etc. Upscale to learn something more, learn something new about human behavior. I'll just quickly tell you about two, three things that are coming up. So next weekend we are coming up with our 55th camp at Manthan. The topic is going to be relationships, past, present, and future. And as you know, all of you are invited for it. So we have a fun filled day. We use it. Ali has his sessions there. And we do a lot of other introspective exercises. We just let go. We become, a child again. We do a lot of stuff, and we do, of course, a lot of introspection on this Saturday. It will be on relationships. So you're most welcome to come. Come with your friends, family. Everybody is welcome. Please get in touch with us for details. So if you want, you can stay back the night on Saturday, which is 13th of February, and you can leave the next day morning on 14th of February, or you can just come for the day, and it'll be really a lot of fun. So that is one. The second thing is that we are coming up with our CLS program, Certificate in Life Skills. So international certificate in life skills, in fact. So you can, that's going to be an online program, so you can do it from any part of the world. And that is starting on 7th of March. It will go on till 20th of June. So again, please get in touch with us. We've already in the last webinar also we saw how life skills are so important, to go about our day-to-day life, not only for ourselves but also people around us. So these are the two things I thought I'll let you know. As usual, the DCS 22 admissions are on, and for more details please contact us and we will be able to help you. Also check out our website for all our latest happenings at Banjara. So see you. Bye-bye. Back to Dr. Ali now.
Thank you, Seema. That gave me a chance to pick up my cup of tea. Okay. Now, I'll give you run through some very, very basic activities. You can add on many more. You can modify. You can do whatever you want. But before that, I just wanted to share with you. My very dear friend, Dr. Shirin, sent me something very fascinating. She got this quote of the famous Martina Navratilova. I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly. She was once asked, how do you maintain your focus, physique, and sharp game even at the age of 43? She gave a humble reply, the ball doesn't know how old I am. And then she went on to say, every game in life is actually played on a 6-inch ground, the space between your two ears, coming back to the brain. The power of the brain and how much the brain can affect and control your body is also brought out by another wonderful book. It is called You Are the Placebo. You know what's a placebo, no? By which, the doctors try to fool a patient by saying, I'm giving you very good medicine and you'll get all right. And because you believe in the doctor and the medicine, the placebo is a dud pill. There's nothing in healing components in it. But still, you do manage to get well because of that. So this is written by Dr. Joe Dispenza. Dr. Joe Dispenza wrote this book called You Are the Placebo, you primarily meaning the brain. This is a screenshot of the book. Those of you who still read books, I would like to recommend you to please read it at your leisure or whatever it is. Now, coming back to what I was saying, if you want to sharpen all parts of your brain or use them, learn a new skill every year. Make it like a New Year resolution. Every year, I am going to be learning a new skill. even a simple thing like juggling balls, you know, those jugglers, what they do, even that helps you in using different parts of your brain. Try using your left hand for activities. You remember the good old days? Yes, that is Dr. Ramchandra's book, Phantoms in the Brain. Thanks, Sunita, for bringing that book up. Okay. You remember the good old days when you were first learning how to write, and whenever you would pick up the pencil with the left hand, the teacher would give you one whack and take the pencil and put it in the right hand and say, write only with your right hand. Fine, she did it for various reasons. Let's not go into that discussion. But since you've spent your lifetime writing with your right hand, learn to write with your left hand. Learn to do whatever activities which you've only been doing by your right hand with your left hand. I've already mentioned to you all these things like Sudoku or any of these mind games. They always, you know, help you. The flip side of it is you get into something like origami or that paper folding and so many such creative, simple creative things. They're very easy if you start picking them up. You can take up that. Do this thing called mind mapping periodically. I'm not going into the detail of explaining. Again, it's available. Literature, Google, books have been written on mind mapping and all those things. You can check that out. But mind mapping definitely helps you to start looking at all sides of your brain. Those of you who have given up the habit, please again pick up a pen or ball pen and start writing. Do not do everything using the keyboard or whatever it is. Start using the pen and paper to keep writing on a daily basis. Read a wide variety of books. Some of us still do read books, but we stick to only the subjects of our interest. So please start reading books which are of a wide variety and as far as possible away from the areas in which you are normally involved in your day-to-day work. The other thing is, please minimize the one-way inputs that you get, which is from TV, videos, nowadays this YouTube channels, all these things. Nice, there's a lot of it to learn. But don't make that an obsession. Don't make that your primary source of activity or leisure or whatever it is. Go more into activities which are two-way, where you have to respond, you have to do something and things of that sort. Similarly, even if you are into sports, start changing the games. Unless you are into competitive game and all that, you're wanting to achieve something, that's a different thing. But otherwise, keep switching over. Doesn't matter if so far you are very good in badminton, take up tennis, take up basketball, take up something different. Just for the sake of it, you will see that that also helps in developing other parts of your brain. Yes, Anjali, the person with the left hand should start writing with the right hand. It's as simple as that. Along with this, let me also show you a slide of a very simple exercise, which will again, like I said, give you an idea about how good you are, and it will help you to sharpen and build up your both left brain and right brain. So Sunita, can you put up the colors, please? Yes. Now you see over here on the top left, what is written? R-E-D, that is red. But what is the color in which it has been written? The color is blue. Below that you see B-L-A-C-K. That means what? Black. But it's written in which color? It is written in red. So when you read this at a fast pace, can you identify the colors? Look at the first one and say that is blue. The one below that and say it is red. The one below that again red. The one below that is black. The one below that is red. So can you read, like how you read a passage very fast? Can you read this not reading the alphabets, but reading or rather analyzing the color in which those words have been written? Very simple. Sounds almost like a children's game, right? But it helps. Because your mind is forced to go beyond. The moment I read R-E-D, my mind says red. But I must force my mind to say blue. Because I am analyzing that that word R-E-D has been written in blue color. That is what we need to do. So, as I told you, I'm giving you very simple tips and techniques and exercises. You can expand on that. You can create your own. In fact, the more you create those which are suitable to you, the more you will be using your brain. Ha, Vinita says, I just want to know, suppose if a person who is very good professionally at his work but not using his right brain, for example, not investing in relationships, is it possible that it will lead to dementia or Alzheimer's? Yes, Vinita, very much. Not only that, the chances are higher statistically. So if a person is like that, I gave the example, if you're a chartered accountant and you're dealing only with numbers, please start doing something which is to be done with the written word. Please start doing something which is to be done with, you know, creativity or design or whatever it is. You can find out what you want to do. And vice versa, if you're a journalist and you're always, you know, using words and this and that, do something which is related to logic or to numbers or something of that sort. Sanjay is asking, does life skills counseling course and practice thereafter in terms of helping others in counseling will help in usage of one's right brain? Yes, Sanjay, I don't want to boast about what becoming a counselor teaches you, but you can ask any one of these students who have gone through counseling courses in the last 30 years. They will tell you the way their quality of life improves. Take a simple thing like our volunteers in various hospitals. Of course, now because of the lockdown, they are on a forced sabbatical, but our huge team of about, 300, 400 volunteers, you will be amazed. Their average age is 70 plus. And you should see how not only they are physically agile, but they're mentally agile. They're living life to its fullest extent. And that is because they are reaching out to other people. That is because they are understanding the wider aspects of life. What if you're reasonably good at both kind of activities and yet you have problems with remembering? Yes, that's what Neelam had asked. You need to go deeper and understand. Perhaps you have not really been using both sides of your brain, and that is why it is happening. Of course, it could also be due to other reasons. It could be because of certain setbacks that a person has had or whatever, upbringing or something. You need to go deeply. Normally, that should not happen, that when you're using all sides of your brain, your basic things like memory and this and that should not deteriorate. But there are ways and means also of doing it. You have these books by Tony Buzan and all that where you can sharpen your memory. You know, he gives very easy and simple exercises as to how to improve your memory. Yes, Satyan, it has been proven medically that any volunteering service keeps aging at bay. And I'm also talking about mental aging, not just physical aging. That is very important. Great exercises for early years also, Kajal says. Yes, that's what I'm saying. Start with children, start with adolescents, start with your own self, even if you're young and fit and fine. This is the time to do it, isn't it? When you are agile, when you have the energy, and once it becomes a habit, these things become so easy that you really don't even have to bother about going out of the way and doing something of this sort. Nas says, it did change my life. Worth it to do these. Thanks a lot. Now, that's a nice compliment. It really gives a boost to, get this sort of feedback from people like you. So please ensure that you are using all sides of your brain. It's a great blessing. Like I told you, the brain is an amazing, gift of nature or whatever you want to call it. And you cannot allow it to deteriorate. That's why I started off by saying that it goes by the use it or lose it principle. So unless you use it, there is a fair chance that you will lose it. Don't allow that to happen. If there are no more questions, we are getting a few greetings and all that, but if there are no more questions, I will take you into a few more points which can add on to whatever I have been saying. Start identifying all the activities that you do from morning to evening and categorize them into your left brain or right brain. You see, if you find a predominance of either of them, start working on the opposite side of it. It's not very difficult. You can do it by yourself. But in case you're getting stuck, you can take the help of somebody, senior or somebody who's a little more knowledgeable that I do this. I drive a vehicle and go to my place of work. Is it a left brain or a right brain activity? I sit and watch this videos on this. Is it a left brain or a right brain activity? Like that, if you keep, Suma is asking, is dementia or Alzheimer's genetic? So far, nothing has been proved that there is a genetic element, because research on this has been very recent. So we don't really know whether somebody's grandfather had Alzheimer's or not and things of that sort. But so far, no indicators have come in. And that's also one of the reasons that we can do that. Vinita is asking, what can a 16-year-old do? To me, 16 and 61 is just a juggling of numbers, because I'm a right brain person, right? I don't understand. I read 1-6 from this side, it's a teenager. I read 6-1 from that side, it's a senior citizen. I know a lot of 61-year-olds who are full of life and behaving like adolescents. And I know 16-year-olds who behave like they are already retired. So don't worry about numbers. To me, age is not numbers. Age is how you are using your mind. It finally boils down to only things like that. And if you are doing this, you will be ensured that somewhere or the other, your quality of life improves, your relationships improve. Next week, I'm going to be talking about relationships post-pandemic, you know, how changes have come into relationships and all that. Now, this was another wonderful example. Nobody anticipated that there's going to be a huge lockdown and we are going to get locked up in our houses and this and that. How we have been able to manage that on a long-term basis. Not just that, you know, I learned cooking or my child learned dancing or we are sitting and playing board games with each other. Those are only short-term. I don't give too much importance to that. But if I have been able to learn certain skills and build up on that, that shows that I have been using both sides of the brain. In fact, there was a very interesting, anecdote or joke, whatever you want to call it. There was this person who had a very, very, very horrifying accident, and the skull was broken open and the brain was damaged. The doctors who started looking at the brain and the patient realized that his right brain is completely damaged, but his left brain is intact. So they said, what do we do? They said, what to do? We will just patch up this right brain and remove the broken parts and this and that. And let us see whether this person can survive with the left brain only. Now, no human being had ever survived with only the left hemisphere of the brain. But what to do? Anyway, he's going to die in a few minutes if we don't do anything. So they removed that skull part, this, that, you know, did whatever damage controlled, and they stitched him up. Now, when he was to come back from the anesthesia, they were watching with a lot of anxiety. Firstly, will he come out of anesthesia? Will he be functional? Will he be able to lead any form of life or something of that sort? This person opened his eyes. And the doctor went to him and said, how do you feel? He said, how do I feel? I feel with my fingers. He had become a completely logical and left-brained person. Now, that is not a very happy state to be in, right? This is, of course, a joke, but I want you to take this up seriously, that this is what happens. Shweta says, one of my friends, very active as a school teacher and active mother of two, and now stopped everything due to health issues. But now, after being all right, she continuously disagrees to work anything. She's very, very active and sharp in whatever she picks up. Somewhere her mood, her motivation and this, that must have come out. So first we need to go through that emotional healing part of it. Then comes the question of what she is going to do or how she is going to be involving herself and things of that sort. Vamshi is asking, is there a probability that we change using from left or right brain depending on our age? We haven't really come across those type of cases very obviously, Vamshi. But yes, if you do make an active effort to develop the other part of your brain, slowly, 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 those activities can build up. That definitely is possible, that you can work on that thing. So in answer to Shweta's question, how can I help her? Please first listen to her, make her talk about everything about her life, what it was before and what it is now because of whatever she has gone through, what are her frustrations, what are her aspirations, as far as possible, if you can make her come out with what she wants to do, go on exploring with her whatever she wants to do. And somewhere along the line, you will find that spark which comes in. Just go on motivating. Don't tell her you do this activity and that activity, but encourage her to do whatever she feels like doing. It will require a lot of patience on your part, Shweta. You'll have to do a lot of hand-holding if she's gone into such a negative thinking process. But I've seen people coming up. I've seen, as I told you, people who have, for example, got, a spinal cord injury and they have become paraplegics or quadriplegics. Some people have withdrawn into a shell and lived the rest of their life as cripples. Some people have been outstanding. I myself have a few friends, who rebuilt their life without the use of their body because their brain was functional. And they did wonders after this accident made them so severely disabled. What can I do to improve my studies is what Vinit is asking. Find out which method of study. This is, again, an interesting thing. Some of us are auditory. Some of us are visual. Some of us are experiential. Some of us are kinesthetic. This, again, is how you use your brain. So I would request Vinit and other students like him to start using different techniques of study and see which is the one that suits you most. So you'll get an idea of how your brain functions and which is the best way by which you can get more and more of studies done and more intake of whatever knowledge and skills that you need to do. Sonia is asking how to help old people who are feeling lonely and going into depression due to the lockdown. Exactly, Sonia. Try and identify the same thing as I gave the example earlier. First, listen to them. There's nobody to listen to them. Make them talk, right from their childhood, their early age, their youth, whatever else has happened. Coming to the time when they moved into old age and how they were coping with it earlier, and then going on to how the lockdown affected them, how it is affecting them now. If right now they have a fear of death because COVID has not completely gone away, first deal with that. If they have a anger that everybody's abandoned them and they're locked up in one thing, deal with that. Primarily, you have to deal with emotions, as we always keep telling in our counseling courses, in our counseling sessions and all that. Emotions control everything, and emotions emanate from the brain, not from the heart. Please don't forget that. If you love somebody, you love through the brain. If you hate somebody, you hate through the brain. And again, we come back to the same point. Keep your brain active. Help these old people by telling them, encouraging them that your brain is so active. You have so much knowledge stored in. You have so much to offer to the world. Even if you can't step out from your place, even if nobody comes to visit you and things like that, it is not needed. You can still, with the aid of technology today, there's wonders you can do, how much you can, spread good news around, how much you can help yourself and get into different types of activities which do not require you to necessarily step out of the house. Is there any connection between brain functioning and sleep? Nice you asked that question. Because if you are sleep deprived, your brain gets affected very badly. This I always keep telling people. Because sometimes when there's a trauma, when there is a depression or something of that sort, what's the first thing that happens? You lose your sleep. No, you start tossing, turning, or you get sleep only after 2-3 hours of going to bed. Or worse than that, what we call as middle insomnia. You go to sleep and then 1 o'clock in the morning, you wake up and for 2-3 hours, you don't get sleep. These are all indicators that there is something happening to your brain which is not allowing your body to shut down at the end of the day and go to sleep. So when your brain is so restless, you have to deal with the causes, what is happening. If you don't do that, as long as your sleep is bad, it will not allow you to be fully functional during the day. You will take wrong decisions, you will be irritable, you will be lethargic, you will be sleepy. All these things can happen. So I give a lot of importance to ensuring that a person gets good sleep. And good sleep does not have to be dependent on sleeping tablets or something of that sort. There are very, very nice, simple ways. Maybe one of these Saturdays, sometime we'll take up this topic itself because I consider it very important, how to ensure that you get a good night's sleep and how it affects your day-to-day life. We'll even take that thing up. I've been getting... lot of, yes, PMS is absolutely a reality and we have to take into account, do not neglect it. It is, again, while it's a biological phenomenon, it also affects the brain, and that's the reason why people get into mood swings and they get irritable and things like that. But the good news is that all these can be tackled. Once you identify that these are the issues, it is a little difficult. It is time consuming. You need to be patient, but you can overcome. But for that, you need to have that basic desire that, yes, I have an issue firstly, and secondly, I want to improve on it, and I'm willing to take help from whoever are the experts or guides or counselors, whatever name you want to give them. So all this can definitely be done. Please give sufficient significance to it, not only for your own sake, but if you are sharpening your brain, please understand that you become a much better productive member of society. Right from your near and dear, your loved ones will suddenly start seeing a changed you. They will start connecting to you. They will start loving you more than before. And you in turn will get the benefits of those, that love that you are getting from your near and dear, which perhaps you were not getting to whatever extent earlier. Once you do that and you understand that this is there, then spread out. Understand that I can also affect people who are in my outer circle. I can affect so many people in different ways. My own life gets enriched. These are the type of things which I want you to please keep in mind. Take it up seriously. As I told you, this is not a professional session into how to improve your brain activity. This is more to help you to understand the significance of it and also to get at least a rough overview and an idea about what all you can do. So all these little exercises, tips, whatever I gave you, were just a means for you to understand that it is possible and it can be done with very, very simple ways. You don't have to, you know, waste a lot of time or spend money or something of that sort. It can be done very easily by any one of us. So keep that in account. Here, Sunita has put up a lot of nice, very interesting activities. Thank you, Sunita. That's very creative of you. You're using your right brain to get out these things. And you, as I said, you can expand on it. You can modify it. You can do wonders. But you can make your life better and you can make the lives of others better. So please do that. Thanks a lot for all the lovely compliments that I got in the chat box. I'm not able to answer to you individually, but believe me, I'm very touched with the compliments that so many of you have given me. Thanks a lot for being an active participation in these Saturday sessions. And we shall continue to do that. Next Saturday, it is going to be on the change in the relationships which have come out due to the pandemic and after this recovery of the thing, how relationships have changed and what we need to do about it. So see you next Saturday. Have a wonderful weekend and a wonderful week ahead. See you. Bye-bye. Jai Hind.